Hey guys, what's up? It is week 254. Let you know the secret top 10 show is still going on, so count on one every Sunday until we hit the season finale at episode 13. Then we'll have a 13-week break, and then we'll start up again if I get a good response, people like it, I find enough guests and everything like that. So yeah, feedback is always welcome on those kind of things. And also, speaking of feedback, like if you ever have anything about me or anything like negative or something to say, like in regards to making the show better or corrections, I welcome all that. But please don't say really rude things to the guests or the people I have on. I mean, I understand if they're not your cup of tea or anything like that, but to outwardly say like really rude things to them, I'm just honest. Gonna hide user from my channel essentially. So if you're wondering why, if you said something really rude on the channel about somebody that was on and all of a sudden your comments no longer get responses or no one likes or downs them or anything like that, it's probably because you've been hidden from the channel, which essentially I believe means that no one else can see your comments, not my or me. And so essentially you're just screaming into a void, which is what you should do if you want to be really rude. Like I said, no problem with corrections or anything else to help the show or even joking, you know, here and there. But try not to aim anything at the guest. They're doing me a favor being on here. The last thing they need is you to say something rude to them. So, hey. Anyways, we're going to hop into the reviews. And the first one up is a doozy. From 1994, I actually watched this for the 1994 22 Shot show we're going to do, and it's getting, I got a 4K release during that, and I was like, okay, I'm going to rewatch this bad boy in 4K to check it out, and this is Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, directed by Kenneth Branagh, who also stars in it as Victor von Frankenstein. Now, I believe the original story by Mary Shelley is probably the greatest, my personal favorite. I don't know if it's the greatest, but it's one of my personal favorite pieces of literature ever written. And it's one of the most influential horror, gothic novel things ever made. So this movie is, it's got an iffy reputation, I would say. Like, as far as like the technical aspects and the cast and all that stuff, it's always admired for sure. Production design, the score is absolutely fantastic. The cast is really strong. Kenneth Branagh is okay in it. I think he's solid in it. But like the surrounding cast, I mean, Robert De Niro as the Frankenstein monster is something pretty crazy to think of, right? And when I was young, it was one of those things where it's kind of like Robert De Niro's Frankenstein's monster. That's insane. That's so silly. But watching it a few times in recent years, you realize how kind of layered his performance is and how he's doing some things very differently as the other Frankenstein monsters we would see previously, like Boris Karloff and Christopher Lee, all those kind of things. But I really think it's kind of a special performance. Helena Bonham Carter is also, Victor's sister, quotation, not really, but adopted kind of sister and eventually wife. She's really good in it, especially her turn at the very end. We also have Ian Holm, who's always great. Tom Hulce, who's always solid as well. Love him in Amadeus as Henry. And Ian Holm plays Frankenstein's father. We also have John Cleese in here. So it's just a really wonderful, top-notch cast. So essentially, it's the story of Frankenstein. Kenneth Branagh is a young man, and in his early age, he suffers a great loss in his family, and he swears that no one should ever die again. No one should ever have to die. No one should ever have to feel the heartbreak of death. So that kind of sets him on his, of course, his studies to become this kind of science, like to science and everything, and he goes to study abroad, as in the book. He meets Henry, but he becomes obsessed with this these old kind of scientists, more alchemists and all those kind of things like that, instead of modern science, and he wants to mix the two, I think. So essentially he gets obsessed with, you know, creating life, not just stopping people from dying. He ends up creating a monster who's played by Robert De Niro, and like the book, he abandons the monster after he realizes what he's done is failure, and the Frankenstein monster, lonely, escapes into a plague-ridden world and sees humanity for what it is and becomes a monster because of it, because he was abandoned. It's so layered of a story, right? And everybody should know that story. They've probably seen 100 adaptations. The thing about Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, it's produced by Coppola after he did Bram Stoker's Dracula, so the budget was there. Like, it seemed endless. So they have all these wonderful moments of sprawling scenery, like in the novel, and all that stuff is pretty top-notch, okay? Like I said, there's a lot of emotional moments. I think that this movie, although it runs at 2 hours and 3 minutes, it's about 20 minutes too short. It feels like some things are very rushed. They focus on strange things like that they should possibly, but then when they don't focus enough time on, you know, the Frankenstein monster or at the very ending, it feels like about 15 or 20 minutes were cut out. The framing story, I believe, is from the novel as well. It's been a while, with the guy on the expedition to the North Pole, played by Adrian Quinn, and he's also shares, you know, the kind of same madness that Dr. Frankenstein has, you know, that quest to fulfill something, to be great, to be different, to live in history forever. So like I said, the score is amazing, the set design is amazing, the drama is really high and it works really well, and there's some really truly wonderful moments that the Frankenstein monster has. He says the line where he says he has so much love to give that you could never understand. But I can't remember exactly the violence or the horror that is in him, or the revenge, something along those lines, that he will unleash that you will have never seen. If you do not give him the other, he will indulge in one. And it's just a beautiful moment. I really like how they play the blind man story with the family in here. De Niro learning while a young child learns, and him kind of adapting and stuff like that. Now, we can't get the inner monologue that the Frankenstein monster had in the book. That was really great, comparing himself to where he got involved with Paradise Lost and the Bible and all that stuff. And I thought that stuff was really great in the novel. And of course, you can't do everything. But as far as Frankenstein stories go close to the novel, it's pretty decent. Of course, they take stuff from the other films, and like they have The Bride and all that kind of stuff. And in the novel, it never is completed, but they do go a little bit further in this. In a really tragic, great scene at the very end. I don't want to spoil absolutely everything, although it is a fucking Frankenstein story, so you should know a lot of it. The way the monster's created is pretty intense. Like, we have a mixture of electric eels and the amniotic fluid, and it's just like and dead corpses and filled with people who died of cholera, and like that nasty stew, and it ends up all over. Like, Kenneth Branagh at one point, I was thinking, Jesus, that stuff must smell so terrible, I can't believe it. In 4K, it looks really great. Like I said, this is a movie that is a big scope. It has beautiful locations, a lot of establishing shots, you know, at different locations around the world. So we have a lot of that, like big groups of people, and like the winter landscapes, of course, are in here. So all that stuff is wonderful. The Frankenstein house is great, with the giant staircase that goes up. They use that. So everything's shot really well. So the 4K, it looks, the scope, it pops out really nice. The surround sound is really great. You really notice it when you kind of have like the lightning and hitting. I think it's only a 5.1 mix. Yeah. 5.1, no Dolby Atmos or anything like that, but it sounded really solid. You know, big lightning strikes, of course, it's the Frankenstein stories are going to have that. But really, the thing that I was most interested in this release, because we had the old Blu-ray from Columbia, TriStar, I believe it was that one, we have a lot of special features. And this is a movie that I like special features on, because it always felt like something was missing. Like, it was like almost the perfect Frankenstein movie, but there was just a little bit of something missing. And when I saw it when I was young, I probably didn't even register anything about it. I just was kind of like, oh, it's Robert De Niro's Frankenstein's monster. It's a little iffy to me. But when I rewatched it for 94, I tried to watch it before that years back, and I just did not care for it at all. But when I rewatched it for 94, I had an appreciation for it. Rewatching it again, so shortly back to back, I had like a fondness for it, to revisit it. And we talk about this in one of the future guests of the Secret Top 10 show. We talk a little bit about this movie, and I think I'm higher on it now than I was when I talked about it in that show. So yeah, like I said, this movie has like a lot going for it in so many ways. It's just kind of like a beautiful failure is what I would call it. And I don't mean that as really an insult, because it's such an interesting movie at the same time. Like, I enjoy that. But the features, I watched all the features on here, the new features and everything like that, and there's a good amount. Brand new audio commentary by film historians Michael Brook and Johnny Maynes, which is really nice, because they talk a lot about, you know, the movie and the differences between the novel. They're obviously big Frankenstein fans, and I enjoyed hearing that. And they give a lot of props to the acting, and them talking about, you know, the end performance by Helena Bonham Carter. You do register that, like, and them, and of course their love for De Niro. Nero in here as well. I like that. Brand new interview with the composer Patrick Doyle, who I think the score in here is probably one of the strongest parts of the movie. It's just a very big, professional, amazingly sounding, heartfelt score. There's an interview with him. A brand new interview with costume designer James Anson, which was also nice. Is he the one who like talks about working with... there's to go back and how like the sets and everything. Like, I watched all these and they all bleed together. It's a lot of Frankenstein in a couple days. Then we have a brand new interview with makeup designer Daniel Parker. That's the one I remember him being in close quarters with De Niro, talking to him a lot. And they said something about having him have to do this makeup for 42 days. And De Niro was like, fuck that. And they were like 21 or something like that. They cut it in half, putting him in makeup and everything. So I wonder why that was, maybe why there wasn't as much Frankenstein monster stuff at certain points. Then we also have Mary Shelley and the Creation of the Monster, a brand new documentary featurette in the origins and evolution of the Frankenstein story, featuring Gothic specialist David Peary, Jonathan Rigby, and Stephen Volk. These guys also come back for the Dissecting Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, a brand new featurette with the same three on the differences between the novel and Kenneth Branagh's screen adaptation. Of course, they're going to go into the ending of this, and they do talk a lot about, you know, originally when all this, the whole thing goes over how the book was published and the different times it was published and all that kind of stuff and whose name was on it, and of course Lord Byron and all that stuff and the creation of the book and all this. And then we have Frankenstein, a liberal adaptation from Miss Shelley's famous story for Edison production. This is the first Frankenstein movie. It's about 12 minutes long, and the Frankenstein monster in that, it's the classic very black and white silent Frankenstein monster, and this looks freaking weird. He's very creepy. I'm sure you've seen a still of him. He's got big hair. It's kind of crazy. And then, of course, we have... it's a 2K master on that, too. We have original trailers, reversible sleeve featuring original and newly commissioned artwork by Laz Marquez. So, yeah, as far as... Oh, it does have Dolby audio. My bad. I didn't want to screw that up. Maybe it's... it says Dolby All. I don't remember it being like a Dolby Atmos score, though. Maybe it's just Dolby 5.1 on there. So anyways, I thought this looked tremendous. I thought it sounded pretty solid. And the movie itself, like, it has so much cool things going for it. So big on scope. Like, and there's some of those movies, those big Hollywood productions that don't always 100% work, but you could sit there and admire it. And over time, those ones always grow on me. Like, I know people hated Waterworld, and honestly, like, watching Waterworld, I've never disliked Waterworld either. I know, but this one always was a little bit more of a sour point for me, because you could almost see the greatest Frankenstein movie ever made, but then these things fall through and you still never top the 1931 Frankenstein movie or the sequel Bride. So anyways, it's still a great release to have. It's got some booklet in here, of course, which is very cool. Yeah. The first couple times I watched this, I didn't even recognize John Cleese in here. He's very hard to recognize. So anyways, just a pretty wild Frankenstein movie, and actually heartfelt as well. So check it out, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein in 4K from Arrow Films. Okay, I'm going to tackle disc 3 in the Shawbra box set. This is Lies and Deceit, 5 films by Claude in here. And like I said, the last week I watched the first two, the cop, the Inspector Larzarjan, and the first one, cop, Cop on Vin. So this time I watched Madame Bovary. And this is another period piece, so it kind of goes well with Frankenstein from Arrow Films. This movie was made in 1990, and the first thing I noticed was how gorgeous this movie looked. This is based off a novel that's very popular. The term Madame Bovary kind of basically became something of a term for somebody that cheats. It's a little bit more complicated than that from my understanding. But this one, it follows the life of this woman, Madame Bovary. At first, she's kind of this very quiet, very gorgeous, very sweet person that lives on this farm with her father. The mother has passed away, so she lives this kind of quiet, peaceful life. The father breaks his leg one day, and there's a doctor that comes in and helps, set the leg and everything like that. And the doctor and Madame Bovary, not yet Madame Bovary, of course, spots the doctor, and they start a relationship. The doctor asks... her to marry, asks the permission for marriage, and they get married. And after that, like, the movie runs about 2 hours and 24 minutes, so it's kind of like this, I don't want to say epic just because it's long, and it's not like this scaling epic of giant proportions, but it's kind of like melodramatic, but it scales somebody's entire life, and there's a lot of, you know, kind of like emotional stuff going on too. So essentially, at first she seems kind of relatively happy in the marriage, but right, like, not even at first, it's pretty quick after she's married, this kind of depression sets in, this kind of loneliness, this kind of longing for more, and nothing really excites her. It's just kind of like a gloomy dread over the entire picture, and the movie looks like gloomy. It's shot very beautifully, but it feels like there's like a kind of dampness over the entire film, like a damp, kind of like dewy kind of feeling on the grass, like a foggy, hazy kind of feeling just over everything in the movie. And I'm not saying that like it's an unclear picture or anything like that, but that's just kind of the impression that the movie gets. But we have this narration that pops in that kind of explains her mindset occasionally and all those kind of things. So being bored with her life, she's bored with her husband, who's a doctor. And he, honestly, throughout the entire movie, he's a little oblivious to her. He understands her, she's sad, but it's like, it's so hard to like relate to her, because at the same time, you would understand that that life would be kind of a boring, miserable existence of nothing. And, but there's so many people that have it worse, but it's just kind of like in life in general and in her situation, it's kind of, it's just a very depressing place to be. So she has luxury, but it just doesn't seem to fulfill her. So she starts kind of like almost trying to have an affair with this young man, an actor who actually appears in the first film in this box set. And they have like kind of a heartfelt thing, but he ends up moving and she's devastated. But she kind of has like these kind of like different feelings where she goes back and forth, where, you know, she's kind of out of love with her husband and in love with her husband. She becomes obsessed with this kind of luxury life of wearing dresses and going to these like different places. She's always a person trying to find herself, and she just never truly can find herself and make herself happy. And like, although she's doing these kind of things that are obviously not fit for the time and not really fit for nowadays, you know, cheating on your spouse and stuff like that, but you never really grow to hate her. You kind of just have these things with her. There's a lot of other side characters, of course, the husband, and there's this guy with a club foot, which it leads to this kind of awful kind of statement about, you know, people trying to be scientists that be like these super doctors that get glorified in this recognition, but they do things that are really not on the up and up. And there's also a chemist that is the doctor's best friend, the family friend, and he's throughout the entire picture, and he's a really good, strong character. But she ends up having these couple affairs and these lives of luxury, and of course this one ends in tragedy, as it would, and it gets even more tragic when you figure out what happened to the entire family. As far as acting is concerned, it's a really well acted film. It's very depressing, very gloomy, and it's an interesting one too. I had never actually seen an adaptation of this story, but as far as the special features are concerned, we have a brand new 4K restoration, original lossless French PCM mono audio, and then we have brand new audio commentary by film critic Kat Ellinger, Imagining Emma, Madame Bovary on Screen, a brand new visual essay by film historian Pamela Hutchinson, archival introduction by film scholar Joel Magny, select scene commentaries by Shaw Charbrow, which, I enjoyed this one quite a bit. Like I said, visually, it's also looks great, and the different locations, but again, the whole movie has like a lingering kind of gloomy feel to it, and I think it fits well for this one for sure. So next week, we'll dive into the next film in this box set, Lies and Deceit. Okay, the next one is from Unearthed Films, and this is 2LDK, and this was originally released by the Danger After Dark, if I'm not mistaken. I remember, this one I had actually never seen. It was made in, like, 2003, and I always have to look at the cover here, 2LDK, because you always want to be like 2DLK, but it's 2LDK. So, yeah, Unearthed really doesn't disappoint, especially when they kind of tackle, like, releases made, like, not, like, contemporary movies. Their older releases are always just something that interests me or really cool stuff. And a lot of their new stuff I really gravitate towards as well. But 2LDK is an Asian Japanese film. And this is a wild movie. So it's basically like two roommates from hell. So I don't think I'm going to be able to give this movie the justice it deserves. And this would kind of require a scene by scene of how it unfolds to get the kind of detail and psychological shit that's going on here. So if that tells you anything. So we have this kind of these two actresses that are both up for a role. They're complete polar opposites in a lot of ways. In a way, they complement each other. If anybody's seen the ending, kind of little thing right there. So one of them is quiet. She comes from a small town, kind of like a more rural area. And throughout her life, she was always kind of like, oh, you're very smart. You're very good at the arts. So she wanted to kind of go into acting and be an actress and everything like that. On the other hand, we have this very pretty girl who's very flashy with her clothes and her perfume and all this kind of stuff. She's a little bit more careless. The other one's very anal retentive. So they're basically opposites there. One has been in like lower budget horror films early on in her career and stuff, and so basically they're up for this role, and at first they're very kind of nice to each other, although they do obviously have some animosity. You can hear this in their inner monologues. They'll be talking and then all of a sudden you'll hear somebody, you know, one of them say something within their head, and they're just it's a really great way to see what they're actually thinking, although they're not actually saying it to each other. And they're both staying at this gorgeous apartment that's basically being paid for, I believe, by the producers or something, like the production, and it's just gorgeous. It's got this fountain and their two rooms. It's just a really unique, cool setup, very visually appealing, to be honest. So over time it starts to escalate until about the 40 minute mark. This movie, I'm going to get the time on here, so it is, I think it's 70 minutes, so literally about the 40 minute mark is when shit hits the fan and it turns violent. They get great on each other's nerves. You get into their psychological state where you can see that a lot of them have some regret, including some horrible visions of somebody in a bathtub. And before long, it just like they're beating the shit out of each other with really odd items around the house, including sword, katanas, and all that kind of stuff. And it's darkly humorous, the stuff they say to each other, the way that the violence unfolds. And it's just a lot. It's built up perfectly, but at times you're on one person's side and then you're on the other person's side because how cruel one will be. But everything's set up really well. And yeah, at points you think that they're going to make up, but it doesn't really unfold that way. And it ends kind of how you expect it to end. I will say that, like, you down to the phone call at the end, you're like, well, I seen that coming a mile away. But I guess that's not really the fun in it. You know, you don't need the not every movie has to have this beat, like this twist, but it kind of does put some statements on, you know, how kind of like this acting competition could be unhealthy for people and how petty a lot of times can be in competition and stuff. So anyways, it's really entertaining film. I thought it looked really great and sounded great. The apartment is amazing. It's violent. It's funny. It's insane. It's just the stuff I kind of live for. But yeah, as far as the special features are concerned, we have commentary with Mano Nonami and Iko Kokiki. I believe these are the two leads of the film, and it is subtitled. And then Making of 2LDK, Tokyo International Fantastic Film Festival interviews, premiere screening interviews, dual production briefing, video message for theater audience, screening at Kudan Kaikan interviews, and photo gallery and trailers. So yeah, anyways, very happy, very impressed with this one. And so just check this one out. I really would recommend it. It's a lot of a dark slice of Japanese comedy insanity. Like it quite a bit. Very fun. Okay, the next one up is from MVD, is it the Marquee Collection? And this is Brian Loves You. And this title was one of the ones that I remember being put out by Anchor Bay, kind of like towards the end when they were putting a lot of more contemporary stuff out, probably in the early 2005, 2006, that kind of time. And I never did check this one out. Now, you can look at the case and you just see it riddled with a lot of, like, you know, genre character actors. George Wendt, Tiffany Shepis, Daniel Roebuck, Tony Todd. Also, Brink Stevens is in here. And I know there's probably some more. Lloyd Kaufman, of course. So, yeah. Anyways, the main star of the movie is also the director. They didn't really do anything else. So, like, I don't want to say that's always a negative or anything like that, but it's kind of like a lot to put on a person's shoulders, right? Their first film. And it's just the time, like I said, they still do it now. But during this time, I noticed a lot of kind of like, back in the day, you'd have maybe a couple character actors pop up in your movies back in the like 60s and 70s, 80s. And I guess it was more prolific than people like to think. But in the early 2000s, it felt like there was like a big convention circuit of people being in movies and everything like that. So, like I said, I like a lot of the actors in here. And Daniel Roebuck and George Wendt and Tiffany Shepis never really do a bad job, I would say. But so this one, what I would say about it is the story is very intriguing. The setup is very cool and unique. We have a psychiatrist that lives in a small, I don't know what size town it is, in Arizona. And he starts to notice that there's a lot of strange, like, kind of people around. They all are in their own religion, and they say Brian loves you. They worship Brian, who was basically murdered as a young man, as a kid, and by somebody they consider a devil. I don't remember the devil character's name, or the devil entity, or whatever they call him. But so they worship Brian, like, kind of like a, you know, this weird, it's not a Christian sect, obviously. They have their own religious beliefs, but it just seems to be him and a few of his friends that are kind of intrigued by this whole situation. And before long, his friends start to disappear, and it gets to be like almost like a body snatchers kind of situation where people are being brainwashed. He ends up being committed to a hospital, even though he's a psychiatrist himself. And yes, and everybody around him seems to be into this cult. And that's kind of the setup of the movie. I like that idea where, you know, what if a cult took over the country? And a movie, End of the Line, a Canadian movie, is kind of in the same vein, which I absolutely love that film. I think it's a really underrated flick, End of the Line. But the concept is really good. It's a found, I don't want to say found footage, it's just a style. Like, I don't, Tony Todd introduces and ends the movie, and he's got some strange things to say. So I don't know if you consider this exactly found footage or not, or anything like that, but it does have the kind of weird cameras, and there's a lot of different, like, footage from just not just his camera, because everybody in this point has a camcorder, but it has, like, you know, security footage and all that stuff mixed in to make the edit. As far as, like, the genre actors are concerned, most of them do a solid job. You know, some of them are a little better than others. Like I said, George Wendt, Tiffany Shepis, and who else? Danny Roebuck really never do a bad job, although they don't have that much to do either. Tiffany Shepis has a little bit more than a lot. The lead guy, he also, like, directed it, and his character is not actually the most appealing kind of character or anything like that. But his situation that he's in, it just kind of sets up for things. And it's also kind of jarring the way it's filmed, the way it's edited, the way the story unfolds. Like, you get the glimpse of what it is, but it's just a little jarring how it unfolds, and can kind of be like a little hard to kind of find your footing to pay attention to the entire thing. The one thing that I really disliked about this movie was the very ending. The character does something so stupid that it almost, you just want to, like, why did I waste my time with it? I just have a hard time buying that the character would do something like that. And it just kind of is aggravating to a certain point, to be honest. There is a side character in here that's in the institution with them that's really full of energy and kind of kooky, and I thought that character was really fun as well. So yeah, this movie is definitely kind of a mind screw, and there's a lot of weird stuff going on. But I'm not sure exactly how I really felt about it, to be honest. There are some special features on here. New 2022 audio commentary with writer, producer, director Seth Landau. 2008 commentary. And then we have a bunch of people on that. Here we go. New interview with George Wendt. New interview with Tiffany Shepis. New interview with Daniel Roebuck. A new interview with star Brink Stevens. So it's got quite a bit on here. So if you're a fan of it, like, I don't think this movie really got much appreciation. This is going to be one that I think a lot of people will really dislike. I wasn't too big of a fan of it, to be honest, but there's a lot of interesting concepts going on, and I think that a couple people will really connect with it. And I think that they could really enjoy this one. And maybe another view will change my mind. Like I said, it has a lot of interesting stuff about it. I like the idea of kind of like the world being completely manipulated by a giant cult or a whole city. Because, I mean, there's groups of people, and not everybody that's manipulated by a cult is just an idiot. It's kind of strange how that works, you know what I mean? It's a lot of different people that would be manipulated by a cult that you would not expect. So yeah, anyways, if it sounds like it's up your alley, check it out. It is Brian Loves You. Okay, you guys better get your pervert cards out, because you're definitely going to need it for this one. All right, this is Sexy Battle Girls, but it has a bunch of alternative names. Yeah, and like a lot of these Japanese kind of pinky or pink Inga films have. So I want to read this to the back here, just this part right here. Director Motosuga Watabe's Sexy Battle Girls is a hilarious pink parody of the classic Japanese TV show Yo-Yo Girl Cop, Sunban-deka, that you won't want to miss. So apparently this television show, there was three television renditions of it, three series. There's been a few movies too. There's one made in the early 2000s, and then there was a couple ones before that, I think, which I actually, Media Blasters or Tokyo Shock put them out, or was it Guilty Pleasures? Regardless, I know that I have copies of them. Never got a chance to watch them. So This is such a weird movie. It opens up in the very beginning where we have this young girl and she's kind of having sex with what appears to be maybe an instructor. Kind of really kind of iffy situation here for sure. But she has this strange chastity belt on, and when it comes off, they start to have sex and we hear a chomp. And she goes back to her father, and her father tells her that that man's your his unit is never going to work again. Because you've been trained for years to get revenge on these people that did your family wrong, dishonor, and everything like that. And she has apparently a super chomp vagina. So that's kind of her power. She has this chomp vagina, which I immediately thought of teeth, if anybody's seen Teeth. And I was kind of like excited to see this movie carry on with a person with the chomp vagina and use that against her enemies and everything like that. So I was a little disappointed to find out that there isn't that much chomp vagina action going on. And I'm going to see how many times I can say chomp vagina in one single review. But she ends up kind of going infiltrating this school, and the headmaster is the guy she's after. We kind of get some backstory on him, how he relates to her mother and how he relates to her father and all that stuff. And over time, there's of course some sex scenes and all that kind of stuff. Sexy time in these movies as many times as they can get in there. But the action is not as fun as I would have liked it to be. Like I said, I would like to see more chomp stuff. It's really kind of not as explicit in that kind of thing as you would think, but implied, and it doesn't happen as much as I would like it to happen. Although when it does, it's fairly funny. Just the idea of it's ridiculous enough. And instead of having the yo-yo, which is what Yo-Yo Girl uses as her weapon from the television show that this is parodying, she uses this weird ball thing that ends up having like some, it's like a vibrator dildo ball, which kind of launches into people and causes them to orgasm uncontrollably. The villain she fights and everything like that. It's a really ridiculous movie. It's fairly short, but it does get a little repetitive, and it doesn't really explore the stuff that you really kind of want to see. It's fun, I guess, but it could be a lot more fun. And it's not quite as sleazy to cover the lack of fun. So nor is it sleazy nor fun enough to really win me over. But the idea that it's a parody of something that I'm not that familiar with, only on just basically the smallest terms of knowing it exists and seeing the cover art and stuff like that. So maybe I'm missing a little bit for sure. But Sexy Battle Girls, it is the weirdest revenge high school movie I've seen with a woman with a vagina attacking. Actually, it's a second after Teeth. I would say Teeth's a little weirder, and I guess Teeth could be a revenge story as well. But the Pink Inga release does have a few special features. So it has the international trailers, and it has trivia. Yeah, so not too much cast and crew biographies and filmographies. So a lot of the old releases, sometimes they would just have that kind of the bare minimum as far as special features are concerned. But yeah, this sounds like it's up your alley. Sexy Battle Girls, then check it out. Has quite a few AKA names, but it was an official selection of the 2009 San Francisco Independent Film Festival. So yeah. Okay, this next one is the Patreon pick, and this is Eau Claire. She said a Disney movie I've never seen. So I was sitting over there looking at my Disney Club exclusives, and I saw, oh, the Black Hole sitting over there. I'd never seen the Black Hole. I knew the cast was amazing, so I was like, let's just do the Black Hole. So I guess the story that I heard is Disney passed on Star Wars back in the day. They were unhappy with that choice, obviously, so they went out to try to make their own space kind of Star Wars style movie. Now, there's a lot of these kind of sci-fi Star Wars inspired movies coming out at the time. We have Battle Beyond the Stars. You have what? The one with the kid in the video, Last Starfighter. So we have a lot of these kind of things. This is 1978, and listen to the cast of this movie and tell me it's not insane. Maximilian Schell, Anthony Perkins, Robert Foster, Joseph Bottoms, Yvette, I always say have a trouble saying her name, but you'd recognize her, Ernest Borgnine, and voices of Slim Pickens and Roddy McDowall, who are not on here. So those are actually voice robots. We have, what is a Vincent and Bob. They're these kind of R2D2 slash C 3PO mixes where they're as smart as our C-3PO, but they look like a little bit more like R2-D2 except cheaper, which is Disney. So I guess Disney didn't always used to have all the money they did, okay guys? They didn't always used to have all the money they did. So essentially what we have here is this space crew. I don't know necessarily what their jobs are. There's some scientists on board, a captain and stuff like that. And they get this distress signal from the ship, and they're not sure what's going on. That it's right by a black hole. They decide to go over to the ship, and investigate and everything like that. It's kind of like an Alien situation, if I'm not kind of mistaking. Although I think this was made before Alien, which is crazy. But hey, Planet of the Vampires is the same situation. So distress signal in space, or maybe it's not even that. They just want to investigate. So they go here. They are kind of like see all these kind of strange people working on the ship. They're very non-responsive and everything like that. And then they kind of are brought to this person who, the captain, who actually appears to be the only live person on the ship. Everything else is robots. And it's Maximilian Schill, who is very bizarre, and he's obsessed with the black hole. He wants to stay there. He's the only remaining member of the crew. He didn't turn the ship in and everything. Kind of think Silent Running or something like that with Bruce Dern, except he's even weirder than Bruce Dern in Silent Running. So at first, a lot of them are suspicious, but they really don't want to put forth the effort and time to figure out what the hell's going on. They just kind of want to get their ship passed together because something happened and get the hell out of there as fast as possible. All the characters, you know, they have like their own personalities, of course. Anthony Perkins is a scientist who starts to kind of have like a relationship, like a friendly relationship with Maximilian Schill, and he's interested in the scientific discoveries and the black hole. And of course, Schill has this crazy idea about making it through the black hole and everything like that, putting everyone's life in danger. Robert Foster is a good captain. You know, I guess he's a good Han Solo kind of style replacement here. Borgnine is more of a money grubbing kind of guy, but I love Borgnine and everything like that. And really, the funny thing is, you have this great cast in here and everything like that. But who steals the fucking show is Vincent, voiced by Roddy McDowall. He's like this quick-witted robot who knows something's wrong right off the cuff. And he finds this older repair robot on the ship, played by Slim Pickens and Bob. And they start a friendship, of course, and there's all these like thuggish, kind of like brutish robots on the ship that are just made by a shell, and they're not as good as the old school robots. So eventually what happens is Vincent and Bob end up kind of like almost saving the day in a lot of ways, like letting the crew know what the hell is going on. And you start to learn some real ghastly stuff about shell and the people on the ship, the robots and everything like that. And there's a couple reveals that are actually pretty scary for a Disney movie. Like one of the mask of the robots comes off, and what's underneath is actually like, whoa, whoa. The main baddie robot, he looks pretty cheap but also adorable. He's like a cheap version of Nimrod from the X-Men, but he floats. He's like, he's really cheap but kind of endearing. So yeah, of course there's going to be some decent action in here, and people do die. A lot of people die. A lot of characters you kind of like, or at least invested in to a certain point, die. And it gets the ending. The ending is so freaking bonkers that I was like, Disney, man, Disney was so weird. Their live action movies were weird. Like Watcher in the Woods, Something Wicked This Way Comes, Black Hole. Every live action Disney movie I've watched from like the 70s or 80s has been like head scratchingly weird and just like the endings are always like, what in the hell is going on? Except Something Wicked This Way Comes is based off of a book, but still, they're just so weird. Like, and this ending is like a fever dream. It's like something like out of Beneath Planet of the Apes or something. The ending of the last 20 minutes of this movie, you're like, what the fuck is this? But I did enjoy it. Like I said, bizarre, weird, solid cast. It's very talky in the very first 20, 30 minutes. You're like, there's a whole lot of talking and nothing happening, but there is kind of setups and everything like that. I would recommend it. I think it's pretty entertaining. But for some reason, when I read Joseph Bottoms, I wasn't thinking one of the Bottoms brothers, you know, Sam, Timothy, Joseph. There's three Bottoms brothers. I was thinking Joseph Cotton. So I was waiting for like a reveal of Joseph Cotton in the movie somewhere. I don't know why I thought that. And then I was like, wait a minute, that young guy's one of the Bottoms brothers. I was like, Joseph Bottoms. I was like, I was expecting to see Joseph Cotton in this movie. And then he's not. And I was just confused for a minute. I don't, this is old man like complaining here. But anyways, it's an entertaining movie. Some of the sets are cool, but like as a cash in on Star Wars, you're like, it's fucking cheap. You're gonna be a little bit better than that Disney. So they just eventually bought Star Wars. So they got it anyways. Yeah, Black Hole. Okay, guys, now it's time to hop into those 1994 movies.
Prison officials say Dahmer's head may have been bashed against a wall.
A day of last-minute appeals failed to stop the execution of America's most notorious mass murderer, John Wayne Gacy.
Throughout, Chikatilo presented himself as a wretched victim of nature's indifference.
Satan approves.
Reality! Why
are you not
about reality?
It's not a solitary story. This is not reality. Not reality. Not reality.
This is reality.
The delusion of a disordered mind. A phantom. A spirit. a ghost.
Look, he hasn't got any relatives, and the coma he's in is irreversible. Give me a signature and I'll pull the plug now.
Fuck off.
Okay, the first up is The Regenerated Man. And this is from Elite Pitchers years back. I actually reviewed this probably like whenever this disc came out in 2011. I probably reviewed this freaking thing. So here we go. The Regenerated Man is by Ted Biogas or Ted he was actually a writer on stuff like The Deadly Spawn, which I absolutely love. Or he worked producing behind the scenes something, writing or producing on Deadly Spawn, which I love. So The Regenerated Man, it had been a long time since I watched this movie. So essentially this is about, a scientist who's working on this new serum. I can't necessarily think exactly, oh, they're trying to regrow limbs and stuff like that. He's a workaholic. He's obsessed with his job. He has a girlfriend that also works there, another fellow scientist. So one day he injects himself with the serum when he shouldn't. And then later on, this group of thugs breaks in and they make him drink all this. They mix all these chemicals together and give him the dark man treatment. They kind of like fuck him up in the lab. You know, they make him drink this stuff. And what happens is he ends up turning into the regenerated man. That's the creature on the front cover here. He's like a lumpy kind of Freddy Krueger thing. And he kills the baddies. He wakes up. He doesn't remember a freaking thing. Think werewolf or something like that. There's a police investigator who's on to the scene and everything. And then at night, all of a sudden people, you know, bad guys are starting to be killed and everything like that. The major complaint about the movie is it's obviously a low budget affair, so that's fine. But there is just scenes where I don't know if they had to hit like an 85 or 90 minute running time here, but literally like there's scenes of him sitting at a computer like a lab working, like, and there's no cuts, there's no coverage, there's no close-ups, and there's nothing happening except him like, maybe like if I set up a camera here for a part of a movie and like I left it right in the middle of the aisle and all you guys saw me doing was like taking movies and sorting them for like 5 minutes. Like, you know, like this is a little fucking long here. And it also happens with a couple homeless guys that have, of course, found like the elixir shit in the garbage for some reason. And you know what? I'm just going to fucking drink it just because that's every homeless guy in every movie is just going to drink shit out of a vial. Think it happens in Primudos, the Olaf Edenbach movie. Like, I'll just drink this. Except his head explodes. Of course, you know, the homeless guy is going to turn into a regenerated man. So that happens as well. But when he's the regenerated man, he looks exactly the same as the other regenerated man. So like obviously when you turn into the regenerated man, you don't have any change of appearance. You just look exactly the same because obviously this was a low budget picture and we had to use the same mask, same outfit, all that. That's fine. These are just like overly like, but these are things, small little things, not even small, they're big things in a small budget movie that it could be considered nitpicking when you're talking about a budget of so low, right? But I'm just saying, I did notice them. They were kind of like, okay. But so I pointed out, anyways, there's some CGI at the very end of the movie that I did not forget. I remember being very dated, and it's probably the most expensive thing in the frickin' movie too at the time, but it did not age very well. Some of the special effects are really cool, like the regenerated male will grow these nails out and he'll shoot them at people and stuff. That's fun. And like the him killing criminals in the middle of the night is also kind of like a la RoboCop, stuff like that. That's cool. Debbie Rochon is in here and there's a nude scene. It's an unpleasant nude scene. It's an almost like attempted rape in here, but she is in here and is a nude scene. It's got to be one of her early roles, I would say, 94. Always enjoy seeing Debbie Rochon. So I don't really know too much to say about this one. It's not necessarily the greatest film ever made. It is longer than 82 minutes. It says 82, but I feel like it's more like maybe 90. I don't know. But I remember it being like, you could have cut a lot of these scenes and edited around this to make it pacing a little better, but back in the day you had to hit a certain runtime. As far as special features are concerned, we have a trailer, still gallery, making of featurette, behind the scenes, and commentary. There's a really funny opening on the making of where he just basically says something about better ways to spend your money and shit. Yeah, it's just a decent little low budget science fiction horror flick with some cool special effects, some not so cool special effects, a little bit minimal coverage, but yeah, you know, a fairly likable lead too, and his girlfriend, I like her too, and yeah, so this is The Regenerated Man. Check it out if it sounds like it's up your alley. Not the worst you could do for 94. Okay, the next one up is one I already covered on the show as well from SRS Cinema. This is the Blu-ray release of Hugh Gallagher's Gore Horror. And yeah, I always love that title. This is like a movie that I always saw in books and everything. And I was like, Gore Horror? What's Gore Horror? And the old tagline was, there's no safe sex with her. So yeah, this is a weird kind of, Hugh Gallagher made this trilogy of like these gore trilogy. It was like Gorgasm, Gorotica, and Gore Horror. And he also made another one called Dead Silence that was made before, kind of thought to be lost for a long time. But these, his gore trilogy is pretty cool. They're kind of infamous in the SOV world. A lot of people know them. The tapes are well sought after. But yeah, so this is the second time watch for me on this one. And I kind of love the lead in this. I love her look. I love her kind of charisma on screen. It's just she's a very bizarre character. So essentially a private eye is hired by this dickhead. I'll call him a dickhead because he's a jerk. And he hires his private eye to kind of follow around this prostitute who has something of his. He says, bring back what she stole from me and the notes and everything like that. And here's 10 grand. There'll be another 10 for you afterwards. So this guy says, okay, he goes for it. He starts falling around and it's really weird and twisted what he finds out. Finds out that this woman is a prostitute, of course. But not only that is she's dead. She is a zombie prostitute. And what she is doing is she needs blood. And she needs this reagent that she has, or whatever you call it, that she has, this serum that this doctor gave her because he wanted to make her, you know, his gore whore, in quotations there. Movie's words. But so anyways, yeah. But there's some really cool stuff in here. The way she uses the serum is with a dildo, which I love. She kills a lot of, like, she, like, will sleep with the John and, like, kill him before she has sex and all that kind of stuff. There's a lot of nudity in the movie, which I find cool. There's a lot of, like, weird cemetery scenes, which I find cool. She raises zombies from the dead to help her, which I like. And, yeah, it's just a really kind of, like, gnarly, kind of gory, sleazy SOV movie that I enjoy. It's short. The sound is really kind of not great. So like at times you're like, what do they say? I can't. It's not great sound. Okay. It's hard to hear. A lot of the stuff is outside. And it's SOV. So the picture quality is not like going to knock your socks off. Okay. I don't know how much better it can get than that, but it is kind of a fun movie with some cool effects, you know, people's heads getting knocked off and shit like that. Of course, severed dicks, you gotta have a severed dick in your SOV movie. I don't even know what you're doing if you're not cutting off somebody's dick. But you get the point, right? And I do like kind of like the female lead. I like how she's got a good look about her. And she's got some one-liners in here, if I'm remembering correctly, that I enjoyed. Anyways, it's a weird-ass movie. It's a weird-ass zombie movie. And I always dig those. See Shattered Dead from 94 as well, which is a weird-ass zombie movie that I always liked. Also from the same year, also SOV. Yeah, so kind of in the same wheelhouse, although one is very... a little bit more serious, and this one's a little bit more kind of punk rock. Even though I would say Shattered Dead is punk rock too, but in the more serious kind of way. I would say that it has, like, you know, a lot of stuff to say. Well, this one may, but it's just like totally loud and in your face in a lot of ways. So yeah, Gore Horror, check it out. There is a DVD release from SRS. All three of them got put on DVD. All three got put on limited Blu-ray. If it sounds like it's up your alley, check it out. Yeah, I enjoy it, but I'm also crazy. So yeah. Okay, the next two from 94 I do not own copies of, but this one is 1994's Moonchild by Todd Sheets. And if this ever gets released, I'll pick up a copy for sure, because I could not find it anywhere to watch. I think there's a VHS release and that's about it. Anything else has been a bootleg floating around. But Moonchild, this is you know, the first of two werewolf movies, if I'm not mistaken, that Todd Sheets did in his life. He did Bone Hill Road, which came out much recently, actually in the past 5-6 years or so. So Moonchild, right when I put this in, I was like, oh shit, this is less of a werewolf movie and mostly a post-apocalyptic movie, and it fits really in the vein with something like Joe D'Amato's Endgame. It's kind of a lot like that. So in this world, we have this organization that kidnaps people and like takes this resistance, and it does experiments on them. It's trying to make these hybrids of like part animal, part man. So it has like all these weird people that they'll kidnap or work on for the agency and make them kind of monsters or mutants and all that kind of shit. So the main character is this guy who escaped from the lab, and they're going to send these like these special like kind of assassins or trackers after him that all have their own kind of special powers too, or specialties. And this guy doesn't know, but he has been infected, not infected, but he has this power to turn into like kind of a werewolf when he gets really upset. So yeah, anyways, he kind of befriends a small group of people that are trying to fight to survive, and it's up to them to survive, rescue this wolfman's son because he has the same powers, and kind of stop the evil kind of faction or whatever. So like the tracking them down immediately reminded me of, you know, of course, Endgame, which is that story where Al Cliver's running away and he has like these kind of high-tech goons after him and everything like that, Eastman and Bobby Rhodes and that. This one is low budget. Like I'll say that it's low budget. The acting is, it's pretty patchy, to be honest. And that could be due to the dialogue, due to the sound elements, all that kind of stuff plays a factor into that. But Todd Sheets has always been ambitious. So Todd Sheets has a large cast. He tries stunts, you know, like big stunts. You know, people I saw complaining about, like, they're like, that truck was going like 10 miles an hour. It's like, bro, this is a low budget movie. They're under a fucking underpass trying to do truck vehicle stunts. I know people say don't work out of what you can do, but the idea that he's even attempting to do vehicle stunts in a movie that probably cost $5,000-$6,000 is impressive as hell to me. Okay, so I'd rather have cheap looking stunts than no stunts. Okay, I know that's like weird to say, but I was like, oh shit, they're actually doing car chases and stuff and people jumping from like trucks. Like, I'm not doing that shit in any movie anymore. I'm not doing that. So you got to give them props for that. Some of the fight scenes, of course, the fight scenes don't look great. Some of them are okay. Some are better than others. Some of them obviously have some martial arts training or some fight choreography. Others don't. Like, especially the first fight you see in the pit. Like, it's just kind of the guy in the mask going, yeah. And he's just like, he's just not moving around very well. Probably because he's wearing a bunch of leather and he's wearing a mask. If anybody's had to try to act in that shit, you know, it's not very easy to move in that kind of stuff and have realistic fight scenes, especially when you have minimal coverage in an SOV movie. So let's be honest. That's kind of what's going on here. But the idea that the scope is this large on a low budget movie, I'm not saying this is the most excellent film ever. I respected the scope for sure. I respected the ambition for sure. And I respected a werewolf in a post-apocalyptic world for sure. Although he's not in it that much, the werewolf, but he does kind of have some changes here and there. And the final form of the werewolf is eh, but when he's like half changed, he looks pretty solid, I would say. There's a cool robot scene too, where it comes out of nowhere, he's fighting like this robot, and then all of a sudden this blade comes out. I was like, holy shit, he's got a blade in his stomach. Think Class of 1999 or something along those lines, which I've always loved. So like I said, there's a lot of cool stuff going on. It is dirt cheap. The acting is eh. It can be talky at times. But for the most part, I enjoyed my time with it as far as SOV post-apocalyptic movies from 1994, post-apocalyptic werewolf movies are concerned. I don't know if you're ever going to find anything with all those things in it except Moonchild. So if it sounds like it's up your alley, check it out. So it is what it is. I don't hate it, but I can't like give this a wholehearted recommend unless you are an SOV enthusiast. Okay, the last one from 1994 is Twin Dolls. Now, I had not seen this one. I had heard a little bit about it, and I heard it's like an OVA, but it's more in the pornographic nature, but it has horror elements. So, man, this is in four parts. Each part's about like 30 minutes. It registered about an hour and 50 minutes total for four parts. I don't know how to go about this fucking movie. This is a rape fest, big time. So essentially what we have here is these super horny evil demons that want to basically corrupt as many young girls as they can and ravage and rape them till they own their souls or some shit. So basically there's this family that there's this young boy who has lineage from the evil demons and from this like kind of holy whatever the family. So he is both. The demons want him because when he becomes the head of hell, when he is corrupted, basically I think they'll have more power and they can finally make their ascent into like the earth. I'm not sure 100% the details of how this evil demon rape shit works, but that's my gist of it. So the points of this are like the demons trying to corrupt this young boy, and he's like four, he's probably like seven or eight, but there's these like off-putting moments where like literally the villain monster is like taking him around like hell, and like after they capture him and he's like showing all these women being molested. And I don't remember if it's like the one creature who has like these weird like tentacles that come out of his head that are all basically dicks, and they're all like screwing the women, and the kid's like, and he's like watching, he's like, oh, that's great, and he's all excited about it and like super horny. But like the heroes of the story are these twin dolls that basically they have like these powers and swords and shit, and they come and fight the evil demons and stop them when they're together. But like they also get molested and raped too at times. But like one of the demons, like I said, is this weird creature with these like tentacles coming out with these dicks and everything. And there's like a major demon god too. I think that might be the same guy. I don't know. It's really crazy. It's really weird. The subtitles didn't match up. Half the subtitles said missing dialogue. So like I said, I couldn't find this to buy anymore. It's been out of print for years. I think it was a Media Blasters release as well. Tried to buy it. Could not find fucking Twin Dolls anywhere. And then like the second part of the story follows a different kind of demon character and he's got these necklaces and they're basically like these sex beads and he like shoots them at people and they go inside of them in their mouths and their vaginas and like basically they just become like this super horned up like women, like they can't control themselves or they're just constantly like It reminded me a lot of Devilman, how like they had the villain of the week and they were really weird and bizarre and creepy, but instead of being like unnerving and scary and effective like Devilman had, these guys are just like really weird and perverted, like basically they have their own weird sex toy and they corrupt people. It's not great. It is fucking weird. It's gross, of course, you know, but there is like a lot of inappropriate ass comedy, especially with that young kid, like, cause after he gets back from all that, like he's like infatuated with like, he's super horny. So like, he'll like these girls pick him up and he's riding in the Jeep and like, he leans back on her and he feel boobs on his back. And he's like, and you're just like, come on, man, this should have got the fucking pervert card. Honestly, this should have got the pervert card over sexy battle girls, because I think Twin Dolls, let's do it. Get your pervert cards out for Twin Dolls as well. You're going to need it for Twin Dolls. I like, if you still got it handy from Sexy Battle Girls, you might as well go in, carry it right into Twin Dolls, because I don't think you're going to need it for this. But yeah, for an hour and 50 minutes, I did lose interest here and there. Like, it wasn't keeping my attention 100%. I don't really have that much to say about it. I wasn't necessarily a huge fan of Twin Dolls. I didn't hate it. It's not my favorite anime. It's probably my least favorite one I've seen, but I'm not somebody that's, you know, seen tons of them. I've seen a handful and liked all the ones I've seen. I've seen the good ones like Devilman, Akira, Guyver, you know, Vampire Hunter D. I've seen like the classics. So like, I haven't seen any of like the real grungy shit yet, or cheap shit, or, you know, evil rape demons movies. I'm sure that's probably a subgenre everything is nowadays. But anyways, Twin Dolls from 94. I don't fucking know. All right, guys, we're here for Blind Spot. This is your pick. You picked 1986's Little Shop of Horrors, directed by Frank Oz. Obviously, the voice of Yoda.
And Miss Piggy. And quite a few
others. And he was in American Werewolf in London. Mm-hmm. So, okay. Yeah, this movie's got a great cast, including Rick Moranis, Vincent Gardenia, John Candy as a cameo, Jim Belushi, depending on the version you watch, Paul Mooney, depending on the version you watch, Steve Martin, and of course, Bill Murray.
And Ellen Green.
Ellen Green. That's the actress in here, right? What else is she in?
I don't know.
She's very familiar. Well, very memorable, I should say, not familiar.
Yes.
Yeah, so I had seen this before, and I remember enjoying it. It's been a long time. And I had seen the theatrical cut. Originally, I never saw the director's cut. I knew the director's cut was completely different, but this was originally a movie made in 1960, directed by Roger Corman.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was made into a musical
by Alan Menken and some other guy whose name I don't recall, and I'm going to feel bad for not remembering it because I think he died of AIDS making Beauty and the Beast. But okay. Go on.
I almost said something rude. I said, that's what you get for making Beauty and the Beast, but I don't hate Beauty and the Beast, and I shouldn't make fun of a guy who died of AIDS. That's just a shitty thing.
Who worked
to say.
On his deathbed making like Disney's first animated like Oscar film.
All right. Sorry. I'm not restarting, but you get the point. Okay. So anyways, Little Shop of Horrors is the musical version of that.
Yes. So. Of the Roger Corman.
No, it's the musical version. This is the movie version of the musical based off the 1960 movie by Roger Corman.
Yeah, this is the movie based off of the musical.
Based off of
the Corman movie. Okay. Yes.
So essentially, this follows the story of mild-natured Rick Moranis. He works in a flower shop for Munchkin. Is it Munchkin? Mushkin or something like that. He has a girl that works there, and Ellen Green. He's absolutely in love with her. Mm-hmm. She has an abusive boyfriend, and then one day he spots this exotic plant that appears to have come out of nowhere. He takes it back, and he realizes quickly that he needs to feed it blood for it to live. And pretty much after that, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
And its appetite more and more insatiable.
Yes. Feed me, Seymour.
So, what do we want to talk about here?
The opening of the movie. I hadn't seen this in a long time, and I love the opening, the Slumtown song, Skid Row. It's one of my favorite songs in there. I think it might be actually the best.
It's my second or third favorite. So I was familiar with the stage version. Yeah. And I'd only ever seen like bits and pieces of the movie. Like if it was on someplace or like looking up clips at YouTube. I love the chorus that appeared. They're the three girls.
Yeah, they're great. And they're characters in the thing. Characters that's the way to do a chorus.
Right, right. They're fantastic. They pop up in the background when you least expect them. Like, suddenly you see more. They're there on the fire escape. You know, they narrate, you know, the beginning and end and a lot of, like, the feeding scenes. I think that they're utilized, like, incredibly effectively. Audrey, too, is an amazing puppet.
One of the best monsters, one of the best puppets. And the way we did that is they had to slow it down. It was really hard. Rick Moranis basically had to act amazingly and slow himself down to match up with the singing.
Yeah.
And I gotta give, I know you're not a big Bill Murray fan, but that has to be one of the greatest cameos in the history of film. And that was originally, I guess it was played by Jack Nicholson, and it was his role in the original.
Okay.
Yeah, so he had that role. But Bill Murray has this, you already know Bill Murray is a sarcastic kind of asshole guy, but he has like a dumb character too he'll play, but this manic, weird energy and his improv, I'm pretty sure a lot of it was improv. He's like, well, I don't know why I go to her. And he just goes on and on, and he's so weird. And basically, one of the major characters in the movie is Steve Martin, and he's a dentist, but he's a sadist. He loves you'll be a dentist. He loves giving people pain. Mm-hmm. So Bill Murray ends up showing up, and he's a masochist, and it's a really great cameo. It's really uncomfortable and creepy, and surprisingly, it went a little far, really, when you think about it, for like a PG-13 movie.
Yeah, but
as graphic violence, but just the innuendo of it is just unpleasant as shit.
Exactly. And it leads into, you know, Steve Martin's fate, the dentist's fate. You know, because obviously he can't inflict pain on Bill Murray, and Seymour's there to do the deed, and it's like, you get in the chair, and, you know, it goes from there. I feel like that this movie, it was like almost like tailor-made for me. I mean, it's a musical. It's got puppets in it. It's
sci-fi.
It's sci-fi, like 50s sci-fi, killer plants.
It's essentially like the Blob that talks.
Yeah. The comedy is fantastic. Ellen Green is this, like, charming and ditzy and just, like, like she's like a horrible person, but not.
She's
like,
not horrible. She's just a pushover. She's weak-willed in a lot of ways, but also really endearing.
Right. But it's weird, though, because she likes the abuse that she gets, but at the same time, it kind of goes too far. It's really weird, because she's like, you know, I would never have him do those terrible things to me. Or like, oh, I want him to, though, but, you know, I can't. Like, I'm a bad person. Like, you know, like, when she drops hints of her story, it's just like, oh, you're kind of a freak, aren't you, Audrey? Okay.
Rick Moranis is great in this movie, and it kind of makes you really miss Rick Moranis.
It does.
But he did. I mean, I don't blame him for quitting and living with it. That's the way to go. I mean, you see, when he does go out in public, some random stranger punches him in the face for no fucking reason.
Oh, that happened.
That was him. Yeah, somebody didn't know, just randomly punching people, and one was Rick Moranis.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, how fucking dare you punch Rick Moranis? Leave him alone. People, how could you look at Rick Moranis and be like, "That looks like a guy I want to punch"?
Right.
Like, he's like this tall. Come on. But no. So like, he's just got a great quality about it, and he's like one of those actors that I can't think of anybody that could replace him. Mm-mm. This movie's filled with unreplaceable people. Every single person in this movie is so unique. I can't think of anyone else who could have played the part. Like, can you imagine anybody playing Steve Martin or Bill Murray or John Candy's little roles, or Ellen Green or Vincent Gardenia? I really can't.
I do know that there was at one point like talks of like making a remake, but I think it was like 2020, and so everything kind of got shelved. But I forget the cast that they supposedly were in the announcement.
Hear me out. Bradley Cooper as the dentist.
I could see that, actually.
Because he's like charming and handsome, but also has an underlining creepiness to him. That's how I see Bradley Cooper.
And he can sing, from what I've been told.
Yeah.
Wasn't he in that movie with Lady Gaga?
Yeah, Star is Born.
Star is Born, yeah.
He's a very good performance. Like, very good performance by him.
Right. No, this movie's just amazing. I just want to keep on gushing at it.
The Christopher Guest cameo is really funny, too, because he basically does exactly what Rick Moranis tells him. He's like, they put the little plant in the window, and they say, what is that? It's cool. He's like, what is that?
Right?
It's so funny.
No, the comedy is perfect. Everything's well timed.
Timing's great. How the plant convinces him, how the plant gets its first victim, and how it builds up. Gardenia's great in this movie. And I know him from Cold Turkey. Isn't he in the one with Cher and Nicolas Cage? Is he in that one as well? The Moonstruck? Is he in that one? I can't remember.
I've never seen it.
But he's great in Cold Turkey. And he actually is in Death Wish 1 and 2.
Really?
Yeah, he's a cop who's chasing Bronson through the first two movies.
Okay.
He's really good in it. And he's a different role from these ones. Because he kind of has the Mr. Krabs thing going on in this movie. He's kind of like the cheap boss, but he's funny. So, like, that thing. And the director's cut and the theatrical cut are majorly different. I'm pretty sure everybody's seen Little Shop of Horrors. If they haven't, then we're going to spoil it.
Right.
This was my first time watching the director's cut. And the special effects at the end were amazing. The song was amazing. And Ellen Green's fate was just super depressing.
So I guess the theatrical cut is the good ending.
Love saves all endings.
Love
like
saves
Brazil.
All. Okay. Yeah. The original ending, both to, like, at least the musical and, you know, the one that we ended up watching on this one is, you know, the plant wins. Which, you don't want it to happen.
But it has to, the way the story unfolds. It just feels right.
Because the story itself is about, like, falling into, like, the praise of capitalism, let's be real. I mean, the opening number, Skid Row, is basically that, how do you escape the grind, you know, you serve the rich and you come home to, you know, poverty, and, you know, you find this plant and you feed it your blood, you feed it your life force, and it in turn gives you money, but it also takes everything away. I mean that's like the movie boiled down essentially to
should,
what it is.
Should
so,
mention that the voice of the plant is from the Four Tops. Somebody from the Four Tops.
I can't think of the name.
It's an amazing voice. It's very memorable. Feed Me Seymour became almost like a pop culture reference. If you say Feed Me Seymour,
everybody knows what you're talking about.
In fact, here's a nice little thing that I cut you off there. I'm sorry, I'll let you get back to it. But in the end of Scrooged, when Bill Murray has his like change around in his heart, he's talking to everybody at home in the camera, and he's like having that moment. At one point, he's like, "Feed me, Seymour," and it's just a nice little shout out to Little Shop of Horrors.
This, going out the ending, like, so we watched the, the quote unquote bad ending or the plant wins ending, and that, like, it's weird because, like, Audrey herself is like kind of like a ditzy character, and like her death isn't like played straight, but like, you still kind of feel something. It's really weird.
Yeah, I was really kind of depressed, and like I didn't remember any of that either.
You know, like because
I didn't see it, obviously. It's
right, right. You know, she has a line, you know, like, "When I die, which should be very shortly, I want you to feed me to the plant." So it's kind of like
self-sacrificing.
Yeah, you know, it's got like black comedy beats, obviously. But like the image of like of Audrey in like the white wedding gown, laid in the mouth of Audrey too, was like the most like it's just a beautiful image, because you know, she's, you know, kind of like in like a sleeping fetus position in the white gown, and she's in the mouth of like all the teeth and like the roses and the reds and purples, like all the plant material. Like, it's just like a, like, I would like a poster of that or something. I just really like that image.
You can't copyright a vegetable.
You can't copyright a vegetable. the alternate ending is, I guess the Love Conquers All ending or whatever. You can tell that it was almost like shot after.
You could tell through the editing, and it just doesn't feel right. It feels kind of cheesy, and then they have a little stinger at the end. The director's cut is the superior one, although it's more depressing, of course.
It's obviously more depressing, but the last song is actually my favorite on the track, and of course that's missing in the good ending, and that's when the chorus comes up and they say this was the plan all along, and then you get to watch like a solid 5 minutes of puppets destroying various cities, swallowing subways.
Oh, that's in the director's... Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, you know...
It's a kaiju movie.
It becomes a kaiju movie. You know, you do miss out on that. So it's like, okay, I can feel better about myself, but, you know, the movie is shorter. It doesn't have, like, the best song. It doesn't have all the chaos and like sweet puppet action. It feels kind of forced, you know, the way it works out. Like, the plant gets electrocuted, like that.
It's a cheap ending.
Yeah, it's not set up or anything.
It's just like in every like horror movie at the very ending when a monster seems unstoppable. And right. Then all of a sudden, it's something real dumb. Like, we have to freeze it. We have to electrocute it. And it makes sense because this is the throwback to the 50s sci-fi.
Right,
and
yeah.
Some of the stuff, look, I don't want to, like, I'm not trying to dog on the Blob because the Blob made sense that you freeze it.
Right.
I mean, some of the times, though, it just feels like it comes out of left field.
You're it comes like, out of left field, or it's like, oh, we're killed by water. It's like, well, the atmosphere is like 80% water. Like, I don't understand.
War of the Worlds is like the first one that did it, but right. It works with War of the Worlds because it's like, you know, the first one that did it.
Right.
Germs.
I don't know. This music is, or this show, movie, whatever it is that we're reviewing. I don't know. I just thought it was fantastic. He's getting into the books already. I will say, though, that the soundtrack, the creators of the musical version that this movie's based off of, they did a lot of the Disney Renaissance movies. Like, and so when you're listening to it, I think you do hear, like, you hear like, The Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Pocahontas, Hunchback of Notre Dame. Like, they made, like, the Disney powerhouses.
It's kind of like when I watch a Shaw Brothers movie and I just hear the library music reused in Dawn of the
Dead.
Dawn of the Dead, vice versa.
Yeah. You know, it's not the same music, but you hear, like, oh, these sound similar. Like, they're definitely penned by the same people.
Little Shop of Horrors, John Stanley's Creature Features, 1986, 3 out of 5. Corman's B-movie and intimate musical were turned into an over-flattened horror musical, following the music and storyline of the play, but much darker and crueler in depicting how a nerd falls in love with a bimbo and feeds human body parts to a man-eating talking plant. What was once a charming comedy becomes an uncomfortable experience, for the screen overemphasizes the slum area of Munchkin's floral shop and the monsterness of the plant. Audrey, too, as it sways humans with its Sevgali, it's got to be Sevgali, like hold. Especially unfunny are Steve Martin as a statistic dentist and Bill Murray as his masochistic patient, carrying to extremes what in the original film was a funny moment. Director Frank Oz was escaping his G-rated Muppet image. Even Warner Bros. Had to lighten up the unpleasant trees before the film was released. You know what's funny is seeing cult movie books not know what a cult movie is going to become a cult movie.
Right.
It's his opinion, though. But that's the thing, is like, this movie was going to be a cult
film. Well, his opinion is wrong. I guess I'll read
No, you're mind. Wrong, Colonel Sanders. Right?
No, Your Honor, you're out of order. All right. Little Shop of Horrors, the 2.5 out of 4 stars, 1986. An elaborate, rather overblown film version of the off-Broadway musical version of the 1960 classic, with Moranis as Skid Row, Flower Shop, Schnook Seymour, who develops a new breed of flesh and blood devouring plant. Lots of big star cameos. Martin and Murray are hilarious as a sadistic dentist and his pain-loving patient, but Green steals it hands down as sweetie, squeaky-voiced Audrey. Enjoyable, but overloaded with too many state-of-the-art special effects and lacking a hard edge in its more good-natured inspiration, though this actually substituted a last-minute happy ending in place of the play's more downbeat conclusion.
I bet he gives that movie 3 or 3.5 if it has the director's cut.
I bet he does, because I do think that the director's
cut... And he liked the same stuff we did. James right. O'Neill, I'm going to be honest, the better taste.
Well, it seems weird that like both these reviewers don't like the special effects, which
one's a sci-fi book. I mean, like that he didn't say anything negative about the sci-fi, okay, but I don't think so. But like, who says that there's too many special effects in a sci-fi right. movie? That's like, there's too much blood in this fucking samurai movie or something. Like, I don't even say that. There's too much blood in this, what is those typhoon movies that right. the Japan movies put out? They're just gore.
I mean, you're watching a science fiction movie.
There's too much.
Literally about a killer plant. It's going to have special effects. You know what I mean? And
what do they want? Day of the Triffids?
Right. Which had like a lot of special effects. I mean,
they
granted,
were special,
it was just
all right.
They were
special,
children,
all right.
But
they were just stick figures. Like, right.
But I mean, you look at Audrey and
I love Dave the Triffids, by the way.
Oh yeah, it was fun, fantastic movie. But I mean, you look at Audrey and like how animated he is. They have different puppets for him. You know, he changes in size so frequently. I think that he might be one of the coolest like monsters I've seen in a very long time. And I know he has a very simple design, but
he's a quintessential killer plant.
Right. He just translates so well, both into this film and the way he looks. And he's stunning and his beautiful at the too. Same time. His voice. The scene where he's waving at Audrey through the window when he's on the phone.
Oh, that's scary.
Like, it's haunting.
And it reminds me of some of my favorite sci-fi horror movies, like Deadly Spawn, mm-hmm. with just the rows and rows of teeth. Anything with rows of teeth are scary as shit. Right. No eyes and rows of teeth. It's just is like these things were made to eat man.
Right. You know, like, yeah, he lacks eyes. He has his like final forms where he's just this big, like, you know, potted fern creature. It's like he is stunning. And then he gets his own musical number, which I don't actually think is in the musical version. I think that was written specifically for the movie and is in both versions to a degree. The Mean Green Mother from Outer Space. I think that this was a fantastic, beautiful movie, and I'm glad I finally got to watch it.
I'll give it 10 out of 10.
I would give it like a 10 out of 5, honestly.
You can't do that.
I can do that.
You can't do that.
Where are the rules? Where are the bylaws? Where's the binder of secrets that we prescribe to? Exactly. Look how mad he
gets. Doesn't make any sense.
It makes sense. I mean, I award this film
all the
2 5-star films worth in one concentrated feature.
I think you took some of those stars from The Shining.
the Shining still owes me, you know, my 2.5 hours
okay,
back.
Okay.
You know?
Now, what am I going to give you? I'm going to give you a choice.
Do I have to address the comments from The Shining from last week? Because I think that there were a few, and I don't typically comment on anything.
Most of them, I had to delete one. I had to actually hide somebody from the. They always comment real weird and rude shit, and they said something so rude that I just fucking did a hide user, so no one will ever see their comments again, and I'll never see them. So like,
was it directed at me?
Yeah, it was so fucking rude that I was just like, hi, comment. And plus, the dude always says weird shit, and I think he's a troll. He's on 22 Shots, always saying stupid shit, too. So that guy can go fuck himself. I hope he sees this, and he's going to try to. He'll make a new account. It'll take him like 20 minutes, and then I'll just do it in 2 seconds. He'll probably thumbs down the video.
Oh, I don't
care. He should thumbs down the video. That would be fun.
Well, anyways.
It was ungodly rude to like say, if you were just like, I disagree, you're dumb, that's fine. But just to say rude, like personal rude shit, just go fuck off.
I mean, I'll go fight him in a parking lot. I'm really scrappy. Like, I do have a lot of pent
up rage.
You don't even know. Anyway, so what are my choices for next week?
Hard Target by John Woo with Jean-Claude Van Damme.
I've seen that.
No, you haven't.
Yeah, I've seen Hard Target.
No, you haven't.
Yes, I have. I see, like, I don't know. It's like every Van Damme movie.
No, it doesn't. Van Damme has two different types of movies.
You're peeking on the damn audio. Who are you, me?
Two different kinds of movies. And okay. I want you to tell me which one this is.
Well, I don't know which one it is. What's the premise of Hard Target?
I'm not telling you. You got to tell me the premise.
Is this where he infiltrates the fort at the end?
No.
Which one's that?
That's Double Impact.
Okay. Which is the fighting tournament? Is that one?
That's Bloodsport. And Kickboxer. And The Quest.
What's the lion one?
That's Lionheart, also the fighting one.
You
haven't
one.
Seen Hard Target.
How do you know I haven't seen Hard Target?
Because you didn't name any of them. You named all those other good movies.
Oh my God, I've probably
seen
Hard Target.
It's not Universal Soldier either.
What's Universal Soldier?
The one where he's a robot. And Dolph Lundgren's a robot.
Oh, and I haven't seen... They're why half robots. Watch the robot one?
They're half robots. They were made as military weapons.
See,
and
he hypes up the other
Dolph
movie
Lundgren's
we're not going to watch.
And like... They're in Vietnam together, and Dolph Lundgren... just in the beginning. He gets all fucked up, and then they use him in these military experiments, and they're all, like, machines. It's pretty cool.
Well, what's the other one?
Hard-boiled.
Why do they all have to have hard in them? What's hard-boiled?
It's a John Woo movie with Chow Yun-fat.
Are you doing a John Woo podcast or something soon?
No.
What's up with the John Woo picks? I don't... He does
I wanted
this
to
shit.
Watch John Woo.
No, he gets a backlog of videos he has to watch for his review because he's too fucking lazy. He wants to watch Night of the Living Dead 15.
I bought Hard Target recently on 4K and I want to watch it. And I know you haven't seen any John Woo movies and I want to rewatch Hard Boiled. Chow Yun-fat. Anthony Wong is in the movie.
Wait, which one is Anthony Wong in?
Hard-boiled. But he's not a major character. He's a goon, but he's the main goon.
But is he like a main goon, like where he has like more than like one scene?
I think he's chasing him. If I'm not mistaken, I believe the Blue Jean Monster and Anthony Wong are chasing Chow Yun-fat through like half the movie.
You know, we're supposed to like recommend like fun movies.
Hard-boiled's a fucking classic.
It's a hard...
No, seriously.
And Hard Target is the most fun you could ever have.
But I want to watch the robot one.
Universal Soldier?
Yeah.
It's not as good as Hard Target.
Well, you pick the movie for me.
I think Roland Emmerich directed Universal Soldier.
I don't know what a Roland Emmerich is.
He's the one who makes the movies where the White House blows up.
Independence Day?
Yeah, I think he made that, but he made more than one.
There's more than one White House?
All his movies.
Well, he probably just like made the model made once making and contact. Filmed it up in no, different
I don't know
angles.
What he did. But no, I seriously, I really like, I haven't seen Universal Soldier in a long time. I like it, but I don't want to watch it. I gave you Hard Target or Hard Boiled.
Well, which one?
Which one do you want to watch?
I don't know the premise for either of them, so you got to pick. I mean, I never give you a choice in force.
Basically, Hard Target is surviving the game, but with Jean-Claude Van Damme, and it's over the top, and Lance Hendrickson's a villain in it, and he's really crazy. And Sam Raimi partially directed it as well. So it's Sam Raimi, John Woo together. You want to do Hard Target?
Whichever one you think I would like more.
You probably like Hard Boiled. Hard Boiled is probably the better movie.
Then let's watch Hard Boiled.
We'll do Hard Boiled then.
You're going to pick me the worst damn movie.
It's a Hong Kong action movie. There's lots of shooting. Do you like shooting?
Not particularly.
But it's like the movie where like they
but
have
they
like
got guns.
Yeah. No, it's like. Do you remember in like movies where they always have like the pistols, like the two pistols they're shooting at each other and stuff?
Yeah, like Norman Reedus.
Like Boondock Saints? Yeah, fuck Boondock Saints. No, I'm talking about fucking Hong Kong double action shooting each other.
That's so cool,
they'll
man.
They'll be like this, they'll be back to back, and then they'll turn around and be like, bah, 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 bah.
Like, ah!
Yeah, they're both shooting
wow,
each other.
They're going.
And they're like, they should be dead, but they're not dead.
Can you imagine that they had like three guns?
That'd they only be... have two arms, Jeremy.
Yeah, but like, what if they had like a third one?
Or like that lady with three boobs. And
yeah, you know, just like, or if they're like, they, you know, because they're action stars, they have
we're
like massive packs.
Fuck it.
And so there's
you ruined it. We're watching Hard Target.
Why are we watching a Hard Target? No, Hard Boiled.
Nope, you ruined it.
Why? No, Bick and Hard. Wait, what's the one with the shooting?
Hard Boiled.
We're watching Hard Boiled.
Okay.
Yeah, we already announced it. Yeah.
All right, let's get into these questions, comments, concerns. Last week I asked you your most prized possession, was it? No, I asked you if you could have any prop from any movie, what would it be? So, Isimicio, am I the only one stressed out during The Shining review? Damn, Jeremy annihilated the film. I don't like all Stephen King adaptations, but The Shining's almost perfect in my eyes, Kubrick version. I remember The Cottage from years ago. It's nice to hear it talked about again. I wish I was cool enough to own original movie prop. Sad. The Maniac. Ooh, that's a tough one. I'd like to own the puppets from the Puppet Master series. I have a soft spot for that franchise. Watching your and Jeremy's discussion about The Shining got me curious. What is your biggest pet peeve when it comes to movies? Whether it's cliche or some element that just bugs the hell out of you. For me, it's when the only thing moving the plot forward is the character being stupid. I understand that mistakes are made during stressful situations, but I can't stand when the only thing moving the plot forward is characters making dumb decisions after dumb decision. Thank you for another great video. Thank you. I hate that. Like, that movie Tailgate is 100% that. Main character just being a complete moron, unrealistically human, and just annoyed the shit out of me. So that one, for sure. At the end of movies, when somebody just gets hit by a car for no reason, like the whole movie, the character survives, and it's like, they will hit him with a car. It's like, you gotta stop fucking doing that. That's enough of that. That's really dumb. Movies that take themselves 100% serious, that live in, are grounded in the real world with plot holes. Like, people never, ever can understand tone. Like, a movie that is goofy and silly, like Dead Alive, it's not in the world that you would understand. Like, it's grounded semi-right, but, like, the gore and the silliness and the moving, like, it has an element of playfulness and silliness and unrealistic stuff that you can kind of get behind, right? But, like, if you take a movie that's grounded in reality, and then it has a bunch of stupid shit, and you point it out, people are like, yeah, but you like this movie. It's like, yeah, it's Evil Dead 2, bro. It's supposed to be like that, and it sets it up right away that it's crazy. This movie's setting it up that this is real life, or it's trying to make a statement about humanity, and it's just full of shit. So over-serious movies with plot holes, I will not give any passes, usually. I mean, I will, but I'll also ridicule the shit out of them. Ja Punk. Claude Chabrol, I think it's pronounced Chabrol. Okay, Claude Chabrol. There we go. My tube. If it is an unusable item only for display... original Freddy's glove or the puppet on the tricycle from Deep Red before its head is broken. LOL. I think Greg Nicotero from KNBFX has the original Bruce Shark from Jaws. That is a really cool item. Michael Bay, love the back and forth between you and Jeremy on The Shining. Great stuff. Jeremy's extreme hate for it made me had me laughing my ass off. Awesome review, guys. I've been waiting for this one. Keep up the great content, Dave. Smudge. For a movie prop, I would want the actual briefcase from Pulp Fiction with a light bulb in it. Only if it was the one actually used in filming, not a replica, because then it's nothing. Elk Vomit. Mutant League Football, the Genesis game. That's what I was trying to think of, something else besides Pigskin Football that was like that. I was talking about the Sega Genesis game when I was talking about Battlefield Baseball, and he said that's the other game, Mutant League Football. There's also a hockey, if I'm not mistaken. Akaba, oh my god, I used to watch your videos years ago on an old account I had. I clicked this video for my recommended and was listening to it while I was working on sorting things, and your voice triggered a memory. You had a video talking about bootleg VHS whore tapes that I remembered. Subbed. Also, where did the hair go, dude? Laugh my ass off. Thanks again. My hair went because it's gray and I'm old and it's a pain in the ass. And the older you get, the hair being long, it's a bigger pain in the ass, especially when it's gray. And you just look like a crazy person. I'm already a crazy person, so why not false advertise? David Becker, love The Shining. It is an unreliable narrator going crazy, or is it a haunted house? It's both. That said, I always thought the end shot was weak. It's just muddied the water for no reason. Invidicus and Antithesis, even though he's being really hard on The Shining, I agree Fulci movies are way better. Zombie, Beyond, House by the Cemetery are all better than The Shining, in my opinion. Now, a lot of people would be mad at that, but I love The Shining. I think it's a great movie, but I'd rather watch The Fulci myself. Barry, also known as BTK. The Shining, in Jeremy's defense, and I love Jeremy's taste in anime and randomly other entertainments he's mentioned in the past. I'm the same way if Michael Bay directed a movie is in... Carry on. So he said, regarding You Ain't Seen, I love Jeremy's I'm not a petty person speech. The Shining is one of my favorite horror movies of all time. I think people get too hung up on the movie's plot versus the logic of events. I just accept the movie's version of its own universe and go along with the ride. I wish we could drop over analyzing differences from books to film and accept it's only an interpretation of the filmmakers. He says, The Shining, in Jeremy's defense, and also Jeremy's taste in anime, randomly other entertainments he's mentioned in the past. I'm the same way if Michael Bay directed a movie is in front of me, I want to run for the hills. I just can't accept Michael Bay's movies. So he thinks, you know, sometimes there's just certain things that some people can't get over. Sherlock Horror. If I could have any movie prop, it'd be the walking cane from House on Sorority Row, which is also used as the killer's main weapon. I have no use for a cane, but if I own that shit, I'd carry it around everywhere. The review of The Shining was fucking hilarious, by the way. Thank you. RB, I don't get the big mystery about The Shining, why people have such a hard time getting it. The Overlook attached himself to Jack because he's an alcoholic with some issues, who I always thought had The Shining just like his son, which is probably why he's crazy to begin with. I don't think the character was able to come to grips with the ability which drove him mad. The hotel is drawn to Danny because he has a very strong ability. I think it's brilliant in its acting, shooting, and creepy, beautiful setting and imagery. 10 out of 10 easily. Not hard to understand it at all to me. Dave, do you think Jeremy would have a different opinion of this movie if it wasn't a Stephen King story? As much as we all like to think of ourselves as unbiased, we're human and really can't be totally unbiased. I admit I'm guilty of this. There's certain actors and directors I typically don't give a chance to, no matter the buzz a movie gets. Tom Cruise, for example. Maybe a little bit, but Jeremy did watch Carrie and he really liked that. I think it's one of these things where he knows Stephen King, so he looks for all these things in it, and he just maybe can't give it a fair shake. Maybe, possibly. But he doesn't have the history with The Shining that a lot of us had, just seeing it at a young age and kind of just knowing its place in history. Because when we were getting older, everybody just kind of came to The Shining's defense. And it was always, ever since I remember, Shining was considered a classic, but before that it wasn't. So Jeremy never had that. Jeremy's not somebody who studies horror movies, and he knows vague history of horror movies, but like how influential The Shining was and the ghost stories and stuff like that, well, like before and after it. So I don't know. Maybe it's hard to say. Jason Bovey, I don't think I've ever seen actual waves of frustration radiate from anyone like I saw Dave emitting during The Shining review. And he says, You ain't seen The Shining review with Jeremy. Isn't that a sign of the biblical Armageddon? Possibly. Maybe nuclear war. Not joking. Autumn Blood, you could try and keep pushing Jeremy to like The Shining LOL, but I don't see it ever happening. He doesn't like it, and that's fine. And I'll admit, I'm also not the biggest fan of The Shining either. It works for many, just not for me. Yeah. I mean, I think that if somebody were to tell you The Shining is not, like, well shot or something, or that would be, like, kind of, like, okay, but, like, just not liking it, it's just, like, all right. Ken Coakley, to answer the most valuable movie in my collection, it would be like asking who is my favorite child. When it comes to collector's markets, I have a Mario Bava box set from Arrow UK. It goes on eBay for $900, which is odd because you can get all the movies individually. Also, being a Dead Trilogy fanboy, I have Dawn of the Dead Laserdisc box set that has an audio commentary that is only exclusive to the Laserdisc. I also have a German import of Dawn of the Dead in 3D, as well as the Italian import of the Dawn of the Dead in 4K. It's a set with all three cuts, but only the Argento cut is in 4K. I have that as well. The transfer was supervised by director of Drive. I also have Dawn and Day on Blue from Arrow UK that are both in the original window box packaging. Of course, I have numerous signed Blu-rays. I was also wondering if your new show will be on YouTube or your Patreon. If it's on YouTube, will it be on this channel or will it be on another channel? It's going to be on this channel. It goes to Patreon first. So Patreon, I have four up right now. There'll be two by the time you see this video. So yeah, so it's gonna, right when I get them edited and uploaded, they go on Patreon, and then they're gonna sit over a 13-week period. So the people on Patreon will be able to watch them way sooner. But it's gonna be on this channel, and it'll just keep shooting through every Sunday. There'll be a secret top 10 for 13 weeks. As for props, an obvious one would be the Garden Troll from Night of the Living Dead, one of the SWAT uniforms from Dawn of the Dead, the fake head of Greg Nicotero that was reanimated. Another obvious would be one of the spheres from Phantasm. I took a picture with Don Coscarelli at a convention, and he had a sphere with him. He would hold the sphere in his left hand and try to make it look like it was coming at you. All the main surviving cast were at the show, and they were all really cool. Maybe that can be a question. Who are the nicest, and who are the meanest celebrities that you met at a convention? That's a good question. I just never want to be too negative, because like, then you just got like people talking shit about like celebrities and everything. But it is always interesting to hear that kind of stuff. Angela Jane Nagy, Almer from Brain Damage, Kayla Elizabeth, John Hammond's Kane from Jurassic Park, or Rufio Peter's Gold Watch from Hook, Ryan Vincent Luxon, the bad motherfucker wall from Pulp Fiction, QT has it. Rob Kopinski, either MacReady's J&B bottle or Irving Wallace's owl head. Jacob B. Green, the corpse from Necromantic. What are you going to do with that corpse? Madeline Deering, the chainsaw from Sharknado. Colin Stone, Belial from Basket Case. Robert D., a baby Suin from Dead Alive. Scott W. Davis, the cane from The Wolfman. These are all really good guys. Curtis Johnson, the split dog from Return of the Living Dead. Split dog. What are we going to do? We're going to kill it. Henry Lee, Ecto-1, John Benzo Frank, penis monster from Cholia and Juliet. John Devlin, beat me to it. And apparently they're very surprised they're the first ones to say it. J.S. Scott, Regan's blood-encrusted crucifix from The Exorcist. Ooh. Doc Glibsby? House Glass from Wizard of Oz. Hourglass. Very dry throat right now. It actually pops up in later films, The Seven Faces of Dr. Lao, too. Vincent Perina, the cat from the Dario Argento's The Cat of Nine Tails. Derek B., the Ebon, the Book of Ebon from The Beyond. Great choice. Jason Wallace, a trioxin barrel from Return of the Living Dead. Avon Warren, that is on my list to make, he said. Derek B., also the Rape Worm from Galaxy of Terror. That rape worm is like the size of a Volkswagen bug. Where are you going to put that, Derek? Christopher Webb, the half dogs from Return of the Living Dead. He also says a Graboid Tentacle. Nick Mua, as I work in a library, I'm becoming more interested in books. So I like The Diary of Father Malone from John Carpenter's The Fog, or The Necronomicon from Evil Dead. The Book of Pure Evil from Todd and The Book of Pure Evil. Questions. Would you ever read The Necronomicon? If it was like from Evil Dead or like any other Lovecraft adaptation and it was real? Abso-fucking-lutely not. How would you reinvent the Cabin in the Woods genre? See, I don't know if I can reinvent it, right? Like, if I had a true idea to reinvent it I thought would be great, I would probably try to make it. But reinvent it. I mean, Cabin of the Woods just kind of did its own thing with that, and that was very infamous and famous and popular. So I wouldn't say infamous, popular. I do like the movie, though. See, if I were to do a Cabin in the Woods movie, now, this is another idea me and Dustin talked about, like, in Zombievers, it's young kids. I like Zombievers, but what if it was like Grizzled Lumberjacks that had to fight the Zombievers? So, like, why don't we just take, like, older people out in the cabins or something? So, I was thinking about this question today. Usually, I don't get a chance to read them before. And I was thinking, I said, why don't we make it essentially, like, the serial killer, or just a killer in general, killed a couple people. He finds out that they're tearing down all these woods at his cabin to put like a highway through, think Deliverance or something like that. And he realizes they're going to find all his bodies and it's going to come back to bite him in the ass. So what he does is he ends up trying to go through and dig up all these bodies before they can get to him. And essentially he's like, there's a nearby cemetery that's not being torn up. He's going to go bury the bodies in a cemetery. He stumbles on the Necronomicon or some sort of evil book, and it brings back all his victims back to life. But they're kind of like animated talking zombies, like think Return of the Dead or Cemetery Man, where they kind of can remember shit. So he's basically fighting all the people he killed. We can make it really fun and have it be like a Black Widow story, where not Black Widow, but like a guy who killed like six ex-wives. It could be like called My Seven Dead Ex-Wives. And that happens in a Tales from the Crypt episode. episode where you have this guy who like marries old women and then they all come back as zombies. We can elaborate that, like he has like to kill his 7 ex-wives or something. Now we're getting like Scott Pilgrim territory here. Anyways, you can do lots of weird things with it. We can just have lumberjacks fighting demons and with chainsaws and shit. So then we have, which film are you looking forward to most this year? That's The Sadness, the crazy Thai zombie movie. I'm loving the new segment. Long may it continue. Corey Zunk, the first Star Destroyer at the opening of Star Wars, or the wood Jack and Rose lay on in the Titanic. I wish you would have asked what original movie TV costume you'd want. Well, you could say that too. It's a prop. James Turner, the blue torpedo car from Stone Age, along with the actual prop of Ox 45 cans. Aaron Fram, a random limb from Frankenhooker. Jason Lindbergh, original Kong metal skeleton, saw and touched it once at a show in Butler, PA. Lacey Liu, Gail Weathers' top story microphone from Scream. Sean Donahue, the shower curtain from Psycho. Zach Puccinelli, the bear suit from The Shining. I love that. And he says, non-horror, the poncho Blondie wore in Good, Bad, and Ugly. Also a great one. Lee Bishop, Freddy's glove from The First Nightmare on Elm Street. Sean Freeman, the chainsaw from The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, 74. Jason Fetters, Peter's gun from Dawn of the Dead. Then you could say that all the time. Ain't it a crime? The only person who can miss the gun. This gun will be the sucker with the bread to buy it. Lonier Leo, movies from Netflix. I think there's a language barrier going there. Sebastian Chanjaro Ares, he put an alien at first Predator. It's like a picture. I don't remember that. Is it like some sort of weapon? David Luton, I don't want very much, just Michele Soave's mask from Demons, the limited configuration from Hellraiser, Patrick Bateman's axe from American Psycho, and Leatherface's chainsaw from TCM. That's it. Let's get right on that. Sean Freeman, Blade Sword. Michael E. Cullen 2, James Dean Switchblade from Rebel Without a Cause. I used to have a replica that someone stole. I think I want David S.'s Switchblade from House on the Edge of the Park is the one I would pick. That's Switchblade, yeah, for sure. Troy Howarth, Helga Ullman's table blazoned with the Star of David from Deep Red. I think you mentioned that in the commentary of Deep Red, that's the one prop you would want. Anthony Ross, The Emperor's Throne, Return of the Jedi. Cody H. Gearhart, The Dragon Knives from House of Wax 5. Stephen Wendling, The Lament Configuration. Eric Whiting, The Ear from Blue Velvet. Stanley Eastman, One of the Hammers from August Underground. Matthew Hudson, The Arian from Neverending Story. A few others came close, but the Arian has to take the top slot. I don't remember what, I haven't seen that movie in years. Aaron, Jerry Vitena, OG Freddy Glove, Cody Lee Harden, the prank crown from Ghoulies Go to College. That's a great one. That's a great one. Drew Marvick, Matthew McConaughey from Texas Chainsaw Massacre 4. What? I don't think he was a prop. I think he was a guy. Donald Farmer, any of the space guns from Barbarella. Kyle A. Rayburn, a film-worn Michael Keaton Batman suit. J.M. Del Rosa, the black Cessna from Night Flyer. I think it belongs to a guy in Columbus. Ryan Matthew Ziegler, King Kong Armature. Eric Eichelberger, Puzzle Box from Hellraiser. Dustin Mills, the Samaritan from Hellboy, complete with the fancy bullets. Wayne Gilbert, Rosebud Sled from Citizen Kane. Nick Weaver, John Harmon's Kane from Jurassic Park. Nicholas Box, the Amulet from Monster Squad. Jacob Davidson, the Mechanical Shark from Draws. Gabriel Cinsaros, something creature related from Pan's Labyrinth. Josh Hayes, one of the 9 gate books from the 9th Gate movie. Jason Lindbergh, the strap on from the 7. Come on now. Marcus Cook, gynecological tools for mutated women from Dead Ringers. And that got a lot of fucking responses. Sean Denny, who called him a perv. Sherman Hurst, the Intrusider. Aaron Mazzola, the Necronomicon from the Evil Dead movies. Robert Mazzola, the Eternal Sunshine from the Eternal Sunshot of the Spotless Mind. Brian Pollan, the green liquid container from Prince of Darkness. David Gibson, the other day this came up when I was watching Gremlins with the kids. I want a bathroom buddy. I think that would be such a cool prop to own and is kind of out of the box. Very cool. Or that fucking ashtray he has in Gremlins. Jay Wall, the rocking chair from Possession 81. I want to sit it and do my best Sam Neill freakout. Matthew Cantor, the jewel from Wishmaster. Kevin Keegan, the Zuni warrior doll from Trilogy of Terror. Michael Allen Fitzgerald, the Bloodstone from Bloodstone Subspecies 2. Melanie Brooke Odom, of course, the Lament Configuration. Daryl Marsh, the ball from The Changeling. Cool. Michael B. Skidmore, original garden shears from The Burning. Jack Castillo, he says, the Welcome to Camp Crystal Lake sign, estimate 1935. That's a cool one. Casey Hansen, the guitar from Slumber Party Massacre 2. That's cool, the drill guitar. Brandon Salisbury, Aliens, basically the big gun that Sigourney Weaver has, and Alien just goes up against the Queen with a grenade launcher. Shane Glass, ball from Phantasm. Stephen McNulty, a traction cam from Eternally Dead. Tracy Allen, Jennifer Aniston's flare from Office Space. So there we go. So this week's question, because somebody was posting something on Facebook about disc rot, and they showed this old DVD with disc rot. So, and I noticed that a couple discs that I had disc rot, and it only appears to be from certain companies. So basically, I want to know, like, discs that I had over 20 years old, 20-year-old disc, 20, 25-year-old disc I have, something like that. Yeah. Some of them had this weird disc rot, but it played perfectly fine. So I want to know, what movies do you have any disc rot on your DVDs? Not Laserdisc, I have all of them. But do you have any disc rot on your DVDs? And if so, what companies are the ones that have it? I noticed that a lot of the old kind of Shriek Show discs are the ones that seem to be the ones that possibly were not made up to snuff in comparison to some of the other companies out there. Because if you take an old, like, old release of something else, like, there doesn't seem to be many problems. Like, I checked the disc, they look fine, but like some of those Shriek Show discs, now I'm just wondering, like, maybe at one point a couple of them got stored in a weird spot. I don't know. I'm really kind of curious to see, do any of the movies you have disc rot, or have you seen anything with disc rot, and how bad did it get, how many movies was it on? Because I've only really noticed it on a couple discs, but I said they kind of all focus on the same company. But then again, I'm also not going through every single movie I own every day looking at the back to, like, disc rot, disc rot, disc rot. So that's the question of the week. Let's hop into this update. Okay, let's hop into this update. First up is the phenomenon 4K from Synapse Films. I had to have this. Love this movie. I love this Dario Argento crazy movie. It has all three cuts on there in 4K. That's right. All three versions. The super long one. What are the different cuts? You have the Italian version, the international, and the Creepers versions of the movie. Nice hard box here. Donald Pleasance, Chimpanzee, Jennifer Connelly, Daria Nicolodi. Another 4K here. We have Hard Target with Jean-Claude Van Damme, directed by John Woo. I love this movie. It's been years since I've seen it. Lance Hendrickson as a baddie. Look at all these cheesy bad guys in the back. You got Sev Thorsen in there. You got Arnold Vassolo. I'm sure the rest are riddled with stuntmen. Anyways, yeah. Also, freaking Wilford Brimley's in this movie. This movie I always loved as a kid. I have not watched it in a long time. Then we have a 4K of X-Ray and Schizoid from Vinegar Syndrome here. Isn't this a 4K? Yeah, it's a 4K. Yeah, these were released on DVD or Blu-ray before from, what is it? Frickin' Scream Factory. But yeah, also included a 10-inch disc containing both. Okay, so you get both of them. Anyways, yeah, cool. X-Ray is a pretty, I never seen Schizoid, but X-Ray is a pretty crazy slasher movie, if I remember correctly. I remember the killer just screaming violently. So we have Hard Rock Zombies here and Rock We Trust. Love the poster art here. I actually have a poster of this one. I don't remember loving this movie. I've seen it a handful of times, but the poster art always rocked. I bet on Blu-ray it's a little bit better, to be honest. And then we also have Slaughterhouse Rock, another movie I never particularly liked. But yeah, great cover art as well. Two movies I both had on VHS. Now I got them on freaking Blu-ray. Of course, Slaughterhouse Rock was put out by Code Red beforehand. So yeah, anyways, a good double feature release, both of them. Then we have Reformed School Girls. Is this a Tim Kincaid movie? Oh, it's a film by Tom DeSalmon. This one I believe I had seen. I think it's really sleazy and crazy and wild. I think Anchor Bay put out a DVD. I love that cover. I remember that cover up for sure. Anyways, this looks like a wild ride. Definitely would want to rewatch this one. It's been a long time. So yeah, Wendy O. Williams is in there, of course. Sybil Danning, of course. Looks like a lot of fun. And I knew I do have like the more Vinegar Syndrome stuff coming, but it's going to be, it'll probably be here tomorrow or Monday or something like that. So we're waiting. And then we have Dream a Little Dream by Vestron, Corey film. This is one that I don't know if I've ever seen it. I know that I've seen the trailer a million times, and I feel like I probably did rent this because I've always was a fan of like the Coreys, because Lost Boys and the Goonies and shit. So I don't know. But we have Jason Robards, Corey Feldman, Piper Laurie, and frickin' Harry Dean Stanton, Corey Haim. That's a strong cast. It's a memorable cast. I'd really like to rewatch this if I don't remember it. Like, it's one of those ones. Anyways, then we have The Accused with Kelly McGillis and Jodie Foster. Heard a lot about this movie. Never actually did see it, but I've heard it referenced a lot of times and some disturbing stuff. I think it's a sexual assault case, and it goes to court and everything like that. So yeah. Then we have Serpico with Al Pacino. Never actually seen this one either. Al Pacino goes an undercover cop. Kind of a classic. A lot of people talk about this movie. So, yeah. And then last is a DVD of Battlefield Baseball. Obviously a rental. But, hey, it's pretty hard to get. So, hopefully this gets a Blu-ray. Subversive Films. That was always a pretty cool company. So, yeah. director, produced by Japan's number one director, Kitamura, who did Versus, Godzilla Final Wars, and a bunch of other freaking stuff too. So yeah, this is a fun movie. I covered it I think last week. So yeah, back to the video, guys. Okay, guys, thank you very much for watching, and as always, have a good one.